Welcome to Ion Connecticut. I'm Mike Savino. In this, part one of our first episode, we're looking at the vaccine rollout here in Connecticut and the disparities in who is getting the doses. We're taping this interview in early February, so we don't yet have race-based data on who's getting the vaccine, but we're already seeing some concerning signs. So to talk about this, we're joined by Health Equity Solutions Executive Director, Takesha Dwan Everett.
Dr. Everett, thanks for joining me. And one of the reasons I wanted to talk to you about this issue is not just because of your work with Health Equity Solutions, but you're also on the allocation subgroup for our state's vaccine advisory committee. And, you know, as the vaccine gets rolled out, we're seeing some of the things that people worried about, that, you know, it's not getting to all communities, it's not getting to all people. And there are people who are, I don't know if you want to say being left behind, but they're not getting the vaccine at the same rate others have. Is this a concern that you had as we were rolling out this vaccine?
Yes. So Mike, thank you for having me. And thank you for this wonderful question and opportunity. This isn't a question and a concern that I had from the beginning. It's the quintessential story of, we have a system that was broken from the beginning, fraught with systemic racism. Now we have a pandemic, and we've created another system to address that within that, without actually thinking really thoughtfully and thoroughly about what does it mean to advance equity in our response to COVID-19. And so I'm not surprised by the numbers, but maybe some people are.
Right. And I don't want to get too deep into the numbers, because by the time this airs, there'll be updated numbers. And also, the state hasn't put out race level data yet in terms of vaccine distribution. But they've given us a map and looking at communities. When we see in Hartford, you know, it's almost half of what West Hartford was at the start of February. Similarly, Waterbury is less than half of the rate of eligible people getting the vaccine versus neighboring Middlebury. So when you see those numbers, I mean, again, we don't have the race level specifics, but are those in your mind validating that fear?
Absolutely. I think looking at the fact that some of our larger, more densely populated urban centers are not getting, having the same vaccine rate as we are seeing in the suburbs, is just showing us the fact that we didn't have an equitable response or kind of a way to address this in the beginning. And I just keep saying all the time, it's not too late. Like, we can change this. It's totally not too late.
And is this something, obviously, at least the attention around the allocation subgroup has been, who gets it? You know, everybody wants to know, when can I get it? But you know, the conversation there has been the groups, the 75, the 65. What about the communities, and how much of that should be something that the allocation subcommittee, or subgroup rather, is talking about as they roll this out further?
Well, I think there are two questions that we need to be focused on as a subcommittee going forward. The first is redesigning and reframing the who, paired with the second, which is the how. And I think those two things kind of go together. The information we were received as a subcommittee, it was designed by the CDC's group, and we redesigned it ourselves and came up with another way of further expanding who's in whatever category. But again, it was centered a lot on age. And I've been a proponent from the beginning of saying, I don't think that's the right way to go. Now we have an opportunity to think differently. Can we explore what it would look like to do vaccine distribution based on geography, but geography overlaid with social vulnerability and looking at that, or geography covered with the lens of where have the deaths occurred and where is the spread of the virus going, so that we have a more equitable way of still going through those phases? So perhaps, if I say this differently, we would be prioritizing places like Fairfield County and Hartford County in our vaccine distribution. And then saying, okay, if you live in these places, whoever you are, one option is, whoever you are, get the vaccine. If you want it, here it is. We make appointments for you. The second option is, let's remain, because maybe there's still a vaccine shortage or a scarcity, if you will, to be concerned about. Then the second part of that is, if you live in these two spaces and you're anywhere within the category of 1B, then we give you the vaccine. And this is a way that we can prioritize and bring equity into the conversation and perhaps see some increases in those urban centers.
And to the point of looking at it geographically, I mean, we do have a massive drive-through clinic in East Hartford, right next to Hartford and in Hartford County. We have one in Stamford in Fairfield County, right near Bridgeport. Yet we still see these inequities. So, I mean, are we doing enough?
Well, the key word you said there is drive through or drive up. And we saw that this didn't work in testing, right? When we started with testing and everything was drive up, we realized, oh, wait, people who don't have cars or who do not have access, the disabled, who may have some difficulty in getting transportation, cannot necessarily make it to a drive through or a drive up. We also saw very, very long lines. So people who still work and still have jobs and still need to be able to do that, don't have the privilege to be in those. So quite frankly, Mike, we need to take it back to basics. How do we bring these testing and vaccine opportunities into the communities where people live, work, and play, where they are already, where they have the opportunity to get the vaccine? How do we extend clinic times? I know I recently heard about a clinic who has done a wonderful job of creating offsite. So right on their clinic area, they've created like a trailer where you can go and get the vaccine. So you don't even have to interact with other people who may be in the daily visit process or disrupt their visitation because they have an entire trailer dedicated to this. But the trailer closes at 5 p.m. So we also just need to be going back to some really small, quick, basic fixes. If we are trying to center equity in this process, then we need to make the process more equitable. Extend the times, come up with different ways that don't involve people being privileged because they have a car or transportation, and focusing on community-based distribution.
We do have a limited supply of this vaccine right now. And also it's the ones we have in Connecticut tend to be the Moderna, the Pfizer. They're very fragile. You know, they can't stay out of the freezer for very long or they spoil, which does make it hard to just try to go into communities and give these vaccines, at least without having appointments and outreach ahead of time to know who's going to be there. So, I mean, just to play devil's advocate, just look at the other side. I mean, what would be the problem with saying, sure, we want to get to everybody, but these drive-through clinics, I mean, we're hitting some of the lowest hanging fruit. We're being incredibly efficient now, and then we'll get into the communities and do some of the stuff that will take longer in the future once we've vaccinated as many people as possible. And what would be the flaw in that strategy?
Well, a couple of things in response to that. I don't think what I'm suggesting is saying that you don't have the same mechanisms for distribution, but at a community level. So when you think about it, you're saying mass distribution in East Hartford and expecting people who have vehicles to come from Hartford, West Hartford, Glastonbury, other places to there. There's a different mechanism of saying you're bringing up a mass distribution site in Hartford that has access to the public system, to the public transportation lines, that has walkability, but also has a drive-up component. So I don't think that what I'm suggesting is too far off from making sure that we are able to have the vaccine in its complete efficacy, like paying attention to the fragile state of it. But what I will say is this, if we continue to focus on aggregate mass distribution of the vaccine, what we'll see is what I'm absolutely certain the numbers show us without even seeing it, is that the people who are more privileged in our society, in our state, particularly those who can afford to have a computer, broadband internet, access to it to get the appointment, who can drive a vehicle to anywhere within the state to get the vaccine, are the ones who are going to be vaccinated first. And they're not necessarily the ones who are at the highest risk of poor outcomes or the highest risk of death. I think we'll still see, just to put it into plain language, we'll still see upper middle class, white individuals who will get the vaccine. And we're consistently pushing out the three categories of people who are disproportionately dying and contracting the virus, which are African Americans, Native Americans, and Latinx populations.
And that was actually one of the things that I wanted to get to is, you know, we're talking about this as simply a matter of equity and making sure that all people have fair access. But there are public health implications here that, you know, we've seen when we get a spike, they tend to occur first in urban areas around the state, whether it's, you know, Danbury, Hartford, the Fairfield County area. And then also, as you pointed out, these are people who don't have the same access to healthcare, have worse outcomes. I mean, there's a public health issue here too, is there not?
There totally is. And I think we're having a really difficult conversation and a very important one, where this isn't about prioritizing people based on race. It's about prioritizing people based on vulnerability, point blank, period. And what that means to me is, if we look at communities overall and we start to target where we have seen community spread and where we have seen death and where we have that social vulnerability, then we win. We win in the COVID-19 battle, because we're making sure that people who are our frontline essential workers, who are overly and disproportionately people of color, that we are also looking at our elderly, who, in a combination, when we look at age-adjusted rates, not only for the aggregate are 75 and older, but for people of color are 65 and 55 and older. Then we add in the layer of comorbidities. We're hitting everybody. Look, I don't know. I still am trying to find the data that says we have a shortage of vaccine. I mean, clearly shortage in comparison to demand. We have far more people who want the vaccine than we actually have. But I also don't think we have to have such a scarcity mindset that we are narrowly tailoring who can get it and when, rather than having a strategic approach that includes a geographical-based, zip code-based strategy that looks at hotspotting, because hotspotting has been around forever. And when you think about hotspotting, again, it's where are we seeing the spread and where are we seeing the deaths, and actually targeting it based on that.
Could some of these numbers in terms of penetration rates into urban areas, could they be reflecting vaccine hesitancy among people of color? Obviously, it's been documented how there's a distrust of doctors for good reason. I mean, there's some history there of people of color being mistreated by doctors. And when you're talking about the older populations, you're talking about people who are old enough to remember something like the Tuskegee syphilis experiment. So could some of this just be, you're talking about people who don't trust the vaccine?
So Mike, I am working currently on an educational program that is addressing the myths and dispelling the myths that are related to COVID, so that we're addressing COVID the vaccine hesitancy. But I want to be frank in saying this. I think it's too early to really say whether vaccine hesitancy has anything to do with the lack of penetration of vaccine into BIPOC communities. And here's why. We have a system that didn't allow for easy access. We don't have, and I'll start from the beginning, using the VAMP system, which requires you to have an access to an internet. A lot of libraries are still closed or have restricted hours. Access to the internet, access to a computer, access to having even computer literacy and understanding how to navigate that system, and the time to do that. So we're already seeing a system that is set up to get appointments and to distribute the vaccine in a way that is systematically inequitable. So what I mean by that is all anecdotal data that I have received to date, which I've talked to a number of healthcare providers, including FQHCs, are telling me that on average, all of their appointments are taken within the first hour of releasing them, and 90% of them are by white patients. So in order for me to say vaccine hesitancy is a part of this, I need a more equitable system for people to actually be able to get an appointment. And then we could actually see, are you equally and equitably distributing appointments, and thus people aren't taking them who are Black and brown individuals, or is there something else going on here?
Yeah, certainly looking forward to when some of this data comes out from the state looking at race level penetration. Doctor, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you, Mike, for having me. Appreciate it.
Thanks.